well. And you have to wonder how each of these guys are really going to adapt to each other when we're already seeing some sort of, I wouldn't say oddball counter picks with the Echo, but some definitely some priority on these counter picks coming in.
Yeah, and a lot of that is because of how much priority was put on mid lane in the picks and bans phase. Parang had a lot of his champions banned away from him by Roccat and by Millenium, so Betsy got a lot more freedom than he's used to getting. When you look at all of like the top champions banned against Roccat, it's all like Swain, Vlad, Malzahar, like all of these champions are away from Betsy, and for once he's like, hey guys, I've got everything available. This is like the first few weeks of the split. Doesn't seem to matter though, because bot lane, Parang.
Just gonna have to flash out. Joker gonna flash in after him though, looking for a little bit more parallel convergence. It may look to get the stun. The parry though, a great first blood. Kaze sees it and takes the free ticket for stun.
Parang, he was trying to dodge the riposte coming out so he wouldn't get locked down, but it also meant he had to dodge out of the shield. Oh, in goes Raze.
More aggressive play coming in. Tabs dashing out, looking for a bit more damage. Good spell shield from Steelback. Exhaust goes down. Masterwork maybe overstaying is welcome, but aggression traded back and forth on both sides of the map.
Oh, Memento wants to go. Only level 4, though, so no ultimate available.
Raze, TP coming in. Masterwork left alone. Knock back into the team. Decent damage going down. Memento tanking the tower, but Parang is back, and he's hungry for blood. That's going to be a kill over Tabs. He's going to walk his way out of that one. Map movement coming in for Roccat. They're not satisfied with that first blood.
And these are the kind of areas that we're expecting the LCS teams to be able to capitalize on that don't get punished in Challenger. Kaze just TP'd back to the bottom lane after the kill so that he would just get the rest of the farm. He's like, okay, well, Parang's going to do the same. I'm going to compound my lead, keep getting further ahead. Thing is, Roccat go, no, 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 no. We're going to make a play up in the top lane, bring the jungler up. 4 versus 2, Millennium without a teleport get punished fairly heavily now, and Parang has just equaled up everything that he just lost down in the bottom lane.
Exactly, I think, where he wanted to be. You can see the farm differential. Echo did give up a decent amount, but happy to get this gold back as we watch this one more time.
As soon as the TP comes out, the pings have already gone down. They delay it so that Kaze has completed. There's no way he can get anywhere close to this, and it's an easy pickup here. The next thing Roccat have done is actually left Parang in the top lane and swapped their duo lane down to the bottom lane. And what that does is all of the farm Kaze that just picked up in the bottom lane is now kind of mirrored on the other side. Not quite, because there wasn't as much in the way for Parang to pick up, but the experience, some farm, and now the forced swap from Kaze is going to delay him farming further. And this is Roccat's nice reaction to the initial pressure put on Parang. And this is what we've come to expect.
And when we look at the gold and we look at the kill score being evened out, there's not a whole lot of difference between the teams, but we start to look at the CS, you can see a difference starting to emerge in favor of Roccat. Not quite 10 CS in the mid lane for the Swain. The Sivir, of course, getting a decent amount as well, as that wave did crash into the tower and deny Tabs a decent amount. But these small advantages kind of start to build up, and Roccat, despite losing out on that first blood, are coming back into this game in a pretty decent way.
Yeah, absolutely. And you look at when Roccat are going to decide to fight and when. I mean, level 6 is a very obvious point for them. As soon as Memento gets there, he gives them the engage tool. Steelback's going to run at people. Betsy becomes so much more tanky when it comes to at least being able to survive, and Parang will have his ultimate available to jump back too. So Roccat becomes so much more difficult to deal with within the next 30 seconds that Millennium have to just be aware of where Memento is. He's now to 6. Ghost is nearly up. It's about 10 seconds away from being available, so could just look to run right into this tower. However, oh, Joko is bottom. The ward has spotted Memento. Roccat have been rumbled.
Yeah, and good movement coming in from Joko. Had the level 6 ahead of time as well, so free to just spend time in that bush, not worried about sapping the XP. But Parang really suffering out in the top lane. Kaze not giving him a break, not letting him get a few items under his belt. Instead, just laying down the early harass here.
And this is one of the problems right now for Parang, at least is the 1v1 matchup, because Parang doesn't have any kind of solid items, hasn't even got one of the components of Trinity Force. He's got bits and pieces of the segmented items, whereas on the other side, Kaze now has the Tiamat, will be able to trade fairly effectively. Keep in mind, Fiora got a bunch of lane-based buffs, added a little bit on the heal for proccing the vitals, a little bit more damage comes from the Q, so when you pair that with the Tiamat, it's small additions, but just makes standing in this lane harder for Parang.
Of course, and as we see Pretty move to solo take down this blue buff, one of the perks of Malzahar. Fiora, of course, a champion that in her kit just has so much power that these small nerfs can bring her back, or small buffs rather, can just bring her back to the meta in an instant. All it takes is a little bit of scaling buff, a little bit of a sustain buff.
Ooh.
Here we go, Parang.
He's back.
He's back. Nice little trick for anyone who isn't aware of it. Echo, of course. Just quick snap back to lane. Makes it pretty easy. Don't have to burn teleport every time. Could be an advantage as they move forward, but of course, no get out of jail free card if Fiora ever gets the all in.
Yeah, exactly. The punish is you kill Echo now. You just you bring someone top, you kill him. It's like, oh, you don't have an ultimate. Great. Everything comes up for Millenium at that point. Kaze, on the other hand of that, hasn't been back in a little while, though. Junglers aren't really around in the top lane for Millenium. At least you can see Joko's hanging around mid has been spotted. So Parang knows he has the freedom. Just a short shopping trip to pick up the Phage for himself, give himself a little bit more survivability. But Parang's impact is not going to be in the laning phase. Parang's impact will be on the flank opportunities that are given to him when the team starts team fighting. And let's not really overlook something that we haven't talked about yet, and that's that Betsy is running teleport on this Swain as well. So Roccat have the multiple options when it comes to joining fights and cross-mapping when it's available to
him. And we've seen exactly how terrifying Betsy can be when he gets a lead, whether he's grouped with the team or whether he's propped up in a side lane and allowed to push in. Swain, not a pick you want to let get ahead of you. Of course, definitely not the strongest mid laner right now, but anyone with a lead can make it terrifying, and Betsy, a true Swain veteran, makes it that much scarier. Millennium, they're not giving up anything yet, and Roccat aren't really moving to take anything aggressively. Both teams seem rather content to just continue extending this laning phase. And for Kaze, that looks pretty good. 90 to 72, the farm difference there.
Yeah, it's a nice little farm difference for them. It is evened up on the bottom side of the map, but one thing I think is key to keep in mind is that Millennium made two plays to begin this game. They waited for Raze in the bush, as we see Memento and Joko trade, and then they made the play onto Parang in the top lane. I like both of those plays, sorry, the bottom lane. But then Roccat reacted fairly well. Steelback played a little bit further back in the lane, now has got himself a CS lead because Memento went up to that lane as well. They brought Parang in, and Roccat have managed to stabilize themselves off two early plays by Millennium that should really have netted them a lead. This game's even, though, between the two.
Yeah,
they're
not looking to keep it even. They're looking to make an aggressive play here. Going to get some damage down. On the Hunt comes in. Raze moving forward. Masterwork in trouble. In goes the team. Down goes the Hecarim ultimate. Masterwork going to fall. TP's coming in, TP's canceled, and Roccat are going to walk away with the quick kill.
Yeah, Kaze canceled his, so did Parang, so Roccat now won't lose anything in the top lane, and Betsy never even used his to get down there. However, look at Millennium already moving out on the map. They want to try and set something up on Parang, who has his ultimate available again, but Parang's already backed away from the turret. Smart play, just to recognize that Pretty had gone missing from mid lane. Now Betsy will able to shove that back out and is able to at least hold on there.
Yeah, taking the opportunity to grab a little bit of the jungle farm. Not going to lose out too much on gold, but at the end of the day, it will be a trade for towers, it looks like. As Millennium look to take this one down. But in the meantime, Roccat just going to back off, spend their gold from that kill, and look to sort of just reset the towers are traded.
Yeah, oh, Echo just ulted back into the lane. I think he's a little too late, though. This tower is going to go down because of that cannon minion being there. If that had been any other wave, he may have been able to save it. But with no TP, now no ultimate, Roccat, Parang at least is going to have a little less effect on the game. But this is the engage. Betsy had already run down here, so no real teleport usage until after Kaze starts channeling his. That's when they both cancel from the top lane and back themselves away.
Not a bad decision either. Parang, though, does get a little bit of CS back, and he has a pretty decent deficit as we push forward, but it's balanced out by the mid laner and the AD carry here. Steelback, 17 lead, about a 10 lead for Betsy in the mid lane as he continues to pressure forward. Pretty a little bit late to come back to the laning phase, and Roccat looks like they want to get more. They want to keep pressuring down on these towers, and Betsy continuously trying to take jungle camps from Joko, which, to be honest, is a little rude, but I respect any man who wants gold that much.
Betsy's going for the inverse Froggen, where you always take the enemy jungle camp.
Ah, I see.
It's like, I could take mine, or I'm going to go over to your side of the map, and I'm going to take those instead. But Roccat have decided they want the Mountain Drake. Joko talked about how Roccat often prioritize Dragon early. This is not a particularly early first Dragon at all. 13 minutes in, a little faster than we had seen.
Oh, Joko's still going to get it! Flash over the wall! A nice disrespectful steal. Millennium, happy to walk away with that one. It looks like Joko's knowledge of Roccat's early priorities does pay off for him.
Roccat taking their eyes off the prize for a second. Did not clear out the ward in the back of the pit. In goes Joko, steals it away. Easy steal for him there. Man, okay, so Millennium get themselves something in this situation, get themselves now that extra damage to objectives. We'll see what the second one is. It's going to be another Mountain Drake. So if Millenium do get that, despite kind of falling behind early, there is the real potential for them to then stand in front of Taos and just push him down. They've got the Fiora, this will benefit. You've got the Lucian as well.
I mean, additionally, think about the potential for them to take a Baron with this Malzahar and additionally have a double Mountain Drake. If they get it, it's such a fast take. Voidlings, of course, love nothing more than a target that wants to stand still. So
they just multiply, multiply.
It's gross. You never want to see that many Voidlings, but it does lead to a pretty quick Baron. Things are calm right now. Stress. I feel like a little passive period here in the lane. Everything's reset after that dragon.
Yeah, we're back up to Australian lanes again. This is somewhat unorthodox. Normally, we don't see both teams up to maintain the laning phase by swapping back up into Australia lanes. At this point, normally you're looking for single lane pushes, or at least
pretty
side.
Ooh. Just gonna flash away.
Yeah.
Playing a little too much footsie with Betsy there. Doesn't respect the potential for an unwanted third party.
Memento was there as well, so Pretty didn't want Betsy to get rid of his shield and then ult him so that he would have been forced to flash anyway. So burns the flash, it's all good. Although Masterwork, I don't know whether you want to be doing this.
It's not quite what you wanted. Fighting for the pink ward. Here comes the TP from both sides. Masterwork once again caught out and in trouble, but he's going to block the boomerang blade. Low health as he dashes in for his ally. Parang looking for a bit more, and Memento comes in. He's challenged up, and Kaze looking to knock him down, trying to get the heal. Parang snaps back, though, and they're going to get in. Betsy continuing to burn down Pretty, and the Mauser Hall does absolutely nothing as Roccat pick up the double kill.
That's one of the first times I've seen Malzahar ult onto the pool as well, do almost nothing. Betsy was just healing up throughout
just,
most of
he just goes
begin.
Bird form, and he just... You're just giving him more targets with those Voidlings. He just gets to heal for free.
Rod of Ages, plus he's got the Negatron Cloak as well at that point, can just withstand everything that was thrown at him. And Roccat ended up coming out of that with two kills onto the two carries as well. Kaze fell and Pretty fell. So is this a good start again by Roccat? They've now extended their lead to about 1,000. So we're going to check out the beginning of this fight again. Masterwork was the initial target for this Memento. Kind of got shoved to Braum. Just in case he wanted him at that point. Kaze comes in and makes a bit of a nuisance of himself, but actually then draws the attention of four people. Didn't catch it the first time, but Parang was forced to ultimate back on top of himself. So there was Betsy just lasting through Pretty, and not a lot you can do about that. Steelback gets the two kills and puts his lead even further out of reach for Millenium. Now it's about 30 CS plus two kills. Massive lead for this AD carry.
And additionally, two Trinity Forces finished up, one for the Echo as Raze. We caught sleeping. Oh no! Kaze is the one who has been caught sleeping. He tries to parry, but it may be not enough. Ray's going to have to back away here. He's so low. Does not have the ultimate. Kaze cutting him down. A massive turn as the double kill comes in for the top laner. And they may not be done yet. They do, in the end, back off of Steelback. What a turnaround, and what was Ray's doing?
Yeah, Millennium's just brought everybody up to the top side at that point. Looked like they were maybe looking for the Rift Herald anyway, and then just kind of find Ray's. And as you said, no ultimate was available during that exchange. But Raze was only about 10 seconds away from coming up, but still, that's 10 seconds too late to save the support's life. And just as soon as Roccat managed to take somewhat of a lead for themselves, they've lost it now to Millenium, who have a slight gold lead, plus now that glimpse of the void on... Raze just...
Shopping?
I think they just thought he was fine, though, because Steelback and Memento here, they think, okay, well, we'll just save him. And then Memento and Steelback kind of don't fully commit. And Joko and Kaze show up. Kind of a weird little exchange.
I don't really know what was going on there. Raze, of course, was so close to having that ultimate backup. I guess just not really respecting the survivability of Kaze. He's got that lifesteal, he's got that sustain, and it's not enough damage coming in quite yet. We mentioned the double Trinity Force earlier, and that's wonderful, and of course going to help you trade out. But it will not help you survive if you're not going to be able to dish out any effective damage there, or if you get collapsed on immediately in the case of Memento.
And of course, the Trinity Force on the Hecarim, we're seeing a whole bunch of... Used to be a second item thing, and now it's like a just get that first and everything's fine, which I'm still not sure I buy into if you're not winning every lane, but fairly luckily for Roccat, they are ahead in mid and in AD carry, so it's not like the Hecarim is relied on for everything in this game. We'll see where Memento goes from here. Normally, just into tank after that. allows you to be the engage tool. The rest of your team follow up. You don't really get too much more damage after that. But that rush before the jungle item is fairly standard these days. Maxwell was talking about it during the post-game lobby the other day. Pretty interesting that Trinity Force is the first item for a jungler. Normally too expensive.
Yeah.
Hecarim cares
it's like
not.
Rushing IE first on a jungler. That's how expensive that item is. Ugh. a little ridiculous, but of course you can see how effective it's been for Hecarim across the globe, and we'll have to see if it works out for Memento here. Joko on the opposite side, already very tanky. Decent farm lead as well, 1-0 and 3 for this Gragas, who's praised as the best member of this team. Looks to be coming true so far, although Kaze's making a good case for himself as well.
Making a decent case. It's not actually the most expensive feeling item to buy, because you got 3 nice points and then it's only like 333. You know what, as we find Joko caught out here, the most awkward item to buy is Rabadon's Death Cap, because you buy an Eva Sea Large Rod and you still got like 1200 to pay after you've got all the components. Like, that is a frustrating item.
Yeah, Zhonya's also.
It's not so bad these days.
Old Zhonya's.
Old one, yeah, where you're like 1050.
Wonderful. Wonderful yeah. Combined costs. Nothing feels as good as spending 1,000 gold on an item active. Yeah, of course, Trinity Force, you can buy it in bits and pieces. Relatively easy to afford, comparatively.
Seeing another steal come out here, Roccat have let this reset slightly. There is a ward in the back of this pit again.
Joko.
Please use a sweep.
Roccat. No, Joko.
Oh my, he's got it again.
Roccat. This man's flash has been exclusively used for stealing dragons for the last 10 minutes.
I don't know what Roccat are doing in that scenario, because Memento has a pink ward.
You don't, I mean, you just don't back off when it's 1,500. I'm sorry, Roccat. That was questionable.
Okay, the first one, I'll kind of say, good job, Joko.
Yeah, you stole it. So, that time it was delivered on a silver platter, as apparently Parang was as well. Gonna have to take a look at that 1v1 again, because we missed the context there, but turns out Rift Herald Fiora, a little bit oppressive in the late phase.
Yeah, she's 4-1 as well, so Kaze now is on a roll now, taking down this turret. I do not know what has happened to Roccat in the last 3 or 4 minutes here, because they have decided, ever since Raze got caught on the top side of the map, Roccat seem in real trouble when it comes to their map movement. So Kaze goes aggressive.
Oh, wow.
Wow, that damage.
That is so much damage.
Straight up kills him.
Okay. Well, we wanted to know. I was expecting an insane 1v1 where everyone used their cooldowns effectively. Oh, no.
No,
Kaze is just huge.
Like, just auto attack.
Just massive Fiora.
Q auto, a couple more, puts the ult down, doesn't even matter. 4-1 currently. Now has a BF sword alongside the Black Cleaver and Ravenous Hydra, so...
Echo is on one item and is buying pieces for the next. This is not a good look for Roccat, and definitely not where Parang wanted to be in this exchange.
Certainly not. I don't know what Roccat are doing right now. They've kind of sat back and are just allowing Millenium to do anything here. Steelback still has himself a little bit of a lead, but I'm now worried for Steelback in these fights, because if Kaze finds him, he's going to annihilate Sivir. Like, there is almost no way, unless you can, like, perfect spell shield the first Q that comes in, or the ultimate somehow, and just make sure that Fiora never manages to get the damage off by peeling for her. That's a tough ask, though, in the team fight. It's a lot on Raze, and to some extent, Betsy with a Nether.
Maybe Memento? I mean, they do have okay peels for Tool, but they're so unreliable against that Fiora, and really, who is going to be able to stop her pushing in the side lane? Because we know the answer is not Parang. And unfortunately, he is once again matched up with this Fiora, who we can be reasonably sure is going to kill him if he can't just clear the waves immediately.
That's the other thing. Parang knows it can't be Parang either at this point, so he's got to be very, very careful, because the last time he died, it was under turret as well. Honestly, a lot of it is the fact Raze has an exhaust as well, so if that hits Kaze, they can lock the Fiora down. Perhaps that's okay, but it doesn't matter, because Kaze just took another turret. 2 Mountain Drakes and a fed Fiora means goodbye any structure.
Well, and additionally, the Rift Herald. And now Roccat are TPing to the mid lane, maybe looking to trade back a tower of their own. They already got one on the top side, and they want to swing this in their advantage. Kolin comes out, body blocked by Raze. Memento, maybe overstaying is welcome.
Here come the top laners.
Oh, the fight's starting to break out. The ultimates have been used, and Raze is in trouble, but the ultimate is going to keep him alive. Fiora calls the challenge, looking for the duel. They're knocked back, and Memento set to drop, but he makes it out. Snapback comes in for Parang. Joko in trouble. Roccat are turning the fight. 2-for-1 exchange in their advantage. What a mess. That was insane that so many people managed to survive. Hecarim barely makes it out, but my god, both teams just so hungry for blood.
Big mess of a fight in the mid lane at that point. Kaze tried to teleport into the fight, but couldn't really hang on to things because Kaze gets exhausted. Watch for it. Raze goes aggressive and manages to come back up and exhaust Kaze right at the last second. And from that, Kaze had to come back down. He couldn't really get on to steal back in Betsy without taking a lot of damage. And that's where the fight started to turn back around for Roccat. And Kaze, too low on mana, too low on health to really make an impact against three here. Seemingly didn't trust in Tabs and the rest of Millenium to be looking to go forward there. They were already backing away.
And Parang and Betsy chain CC there between the parallel convergence and the never move. Really strong. I mean, teamfight coordination, we praised them for it before. And it was on these picks. Pretty good for them thus far. Of course, need to kind of tighten up the decision-making here as they push forward. They brought it back to just about even, of course, between the Rift Herald buff and two Mountain Dragons. Millennium do still have a lead, but it's not in the gold anymore. And now, as Roccat sets up to control this area around Baron, this is a good opportunity for them to potentially use this very strong composition.
Yeah, it's a good opportunity, but I gotta look at what Millennium have done so far in this game. Aside from a couple of mistakes here and there, generally have been able to regroup very effectively.
Moving forward, Memento gonna dash out. Kaze on the hunt. Parallel convergence comes down. No one's going to follow on that. But Hecarim ultimate is down.
They've shoved Roccat back away from the Baron pit, though. Millennium now have some sense of control. If they can clear out some of the wards, who taps out on his own.
Not where you wanted to be. Raze gets it. Is not going to get anything else, though. Malzahar on the side, locking down Memento. Can he get the kill back? Looks like the answer is yes. The reset on the Malefic Visions as well. So much damage across this teamfight. Prank snaps back, but it may be to his death. Nope, Betsy there to back him up. Kaze running forward. The Swain may be unkillable, but he can't kill anyone else in return. Millennium picking up the 2-0.
No exhaust and no real way of dealing with the damage coming out from Malzahar at that point. They couldn't exhaust Kaze, so have to back away from the rest of the team fight. And Steelback did a good amount of damage to begin with, and it was the right call from Roccat to go aggressive on Tabs, who was out on his own, but they couldn't fully capitalize on it. Tabs just burned his heal very early on to make sure he survived through that fight. And now Millennium are looking for another turret here. Millennium have got...
And they're gonna get it. Betsy takes a stack and cuts it blows. Parallel convergence comes out. And Millennium are going to back off. There's another dragon in 12 seconds. Joko's making his way. He's got low mana. I think he's going to be able to take this one. We'll have to see if Roccat are going to be able to grab their first dragon. This one will be contested once again. Joko locked up as we go into the replay.
Yeah, going into the replay. This is the engage on Tabs. Looks like Joko is out safe from that engage. So the suppression onto Memento allowed them to take him down, got that spread of the Malefic Visions at that point as well. And Betsy tries to come in from the top side, but managed to get a couple of lockdowns there, but that was about it. And just looking at the bottom left of your screen, we have seen the Ocean Drake go over to Roccat. So not quite as useful perhaps as the two Mountain Drakes coming out, but still, I guess he's one dragon secured out of three
better,
for Roccat.
Better than to give another one away. Yeah, an unfortunate set of circumstances for Roccat and dragons this game.
Yeah, considering how much damage to the dragons Roccat have done, basically the rest of them has been...
That's a stat. Yeah, that's a stat I'd love to see, because I would guess that it's 90% of the damage dealt to dragons in this game has been Roccat.
Yep.
And a crisp however much two smites worth of damage is for Joko.
And honestly, that has been one of the most frustrating things of watching Roccat in this game specifically, is I feel like perhaps they're underestimating Millennium, being a little greedy. Hang on, Memento.
Oh, Kaze does so much damage. Cass comes out. Millennium now are able to back off, but the pony's been set back. Use the ultimate O's as well, but Joko's getting collapsed on. Not going to get locked up by the Nevermore. Now dashing out. Both teams just seem so ready for a fight, but Roccat have to be smart about this. Kaze, really just a monster, bloodthirster. Yeah. Hasn't even finished Boots 2.
He's like, I don't need Boots, I just need a bigger sword. That's all I gotta get. He's been playing too much Howling Abyss. That is exactly what the shopkeeper would tell you on there. But 4-1-2 on this Fiora is basically uncontrollable over in a side lane. Roccat need to try and force fights together when they have a lot of their team fighting tools available to them, and that's how you drag away the Fiora. As long as the lane isn't kind of where it is right now, which is actually probably they can't afford to force a fight because Fiora...
Oh, they're going to try to do it. Ult comes in. Counter looking to turn. Malzahar does so much damage, and they're fighting in the midst of everything he has, but Roccat are able to get this. Colin comes out. Betsy running for his life as the healing is mitigated. trying to heal what he can in the meantime. But here comes the Fiora flank. Betsy, Zhonya's up, but I don't think it's going to be enough. Fiora over the wall. She's going to look to grab a couple kills, but Steelback, fancy footwork. Prang on the way in. It's not enough. He may have sent himself to death as well. He's going to get stunned by the concussive blows. Double kill drops in the end for Kaze, and Millenium absolutely massacre Roccat.
And Roccat were in a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation right there, because Roccat wanted to engage, but Prang couldn't teleport in until Kaze had started the channel on his, because if he does teleport out of the lane, Kaze just takes the inhib. Now Millenium are just going to take away the Baron.
Memento goes over, he gets it! Oh, a little payback on the side of Roccat for Joko's earlier steals. Memento may not make it out with his life. Or will he?
Oh.
In true fashionable form.
Oh, man, this has been a game of missed smites and a lot of tears around objectives. Raze managed to get the Baron buff as well. Here was the engage. Look at the top lane of positioning here. Watch Kaze drop all the way back in the lane as his teamfight progresses. Roccat took too much damage. And the reason Prang can't go here is because until he sees this moment, he cannot be sure that Fiora won't just push for his inhib. So Steelback is still in the mix of this fight. They can't fully get themselves out because there's too much damage from Millenium here. Prang ends up falling as well, just from the Fiora damage. And how does this happen? Because Braum is blocking here, and oh,
boom! Where would he help?
Oh, he's not. How it happened. Okay.
All right. Apologies to the audience. Yeah, Maybe you noticed before us, but no smite is definitely a problem. It's definitely not no smite, no problem.
Yeah. Millennium. Okay. Oof. We're getting a little bit.
Oh, Joko caught out. Roccat gonna look for a kill back, as he's gonna try to knock them away. Glacial Fisher to follow up as well, but look at that last teamfight damage. Fiora may have cleaned up, but grouping up against the Malzahar was definitely a death sentence there for Roccat.
Yeah, grouping up right on top of that null zone. Feel a little stupid for not realizing Joko was dead for the majority of the Baron attack.
As do I.
Yeah, well, that's why we got the replay sometimes. I was like, why was there no smite? Look at the bottom of the screen. And I'm like,
Joko had smite. Ah, yes, but he was dead and nowhere near the Baron.
Nice.
Damn you, smite. No global range.
Hey, we were saying, I said it was a game of missed smites. I guess that one we can,
yeah,
we can let go.
Someone finally hit a smite is what we can say. Yeah, it was Memento.
Nice.
Roccat, though, using this Baron buff to push in. But the Fiora, an endless threat on the top side of the map, and one they're going to have to respect. Prang, a little bit more tools to deal with her now, but does not get easier from here. She picks up the Executioner's Calling. A special treat just for Betsy in the coming team fights.
Yeah, man, it's a big point of contention, or at least like a big praise to how Kaze's been playing the fight. I'll just build an Executioner's Calling. Doesn't really matter. I need it. Need
That's
it
how you know you're ahead.
Swain. Yeah.
It's probably like a GA coming. It's like, I'm good.
Just have a quick stop off at something to make sure that you can deal with the Swain, because that was one of the other things is Millenium have not taken an ignite outside of that, so relying a little bit more on the grievous wounds that comes from the Morel and Omicron, but at that point you've got to get them down below 35% health, which is always the tricky bit at first.
It's nice now Kaze can come in, inflict those grievous wounds at any time. Now Millenium, they're waiting in the brush, maybe looking for an opportunity here. There's a dragon on the way. The new and improved Cloud Drake.
Improved. I agree. It is improved. It's still satisfying.
Knock
race,
the stop
though.
From starting to fight, though. They move forward. Kaze caught out. He's going to parry at least one ability, but now he's in the middle of the team. He gets shut down. Roccat, they're taking control. They are on the hunt, and they're pushing forward. Masterwork blocks what he can, but there's no tickets left for him to get out. Or is there? Stand behind me. Memento moving forward, looking for the parallel convergence for Prang, and they're just going to keep pushing. They have made the murder train, and they are going to completion. The turnaround, Pretty, trying to keep this one rolling. Betsy suddenly on the backside. Tabs doesn't have the tools to fight him. He goes golden. He cleans house. Roccat, take control.
Big teamfight win for Roccat here is going to result likely in them attempting the mid inhibitor for now, but Pretty is here, and he does have enough wave clear. Memento is dangerously close to dying here. If he gets comboed out by Malzahar, he has to be careful. Here comes the TP to keep the cannon minion alive so they can take down this inhib. 24 seconds still on a lot of the wave clear that's going to come out from the rest of the Millennium lineup. So this inhib is gone, and Roccat finally find their form in a team fight against Millennium, but this has been a very back and forth performance.
Absolutely, and the gold. 1.5k difference still present between these teams. That is nothing at 30 minutes, but man, the inhibitor getting broken down is everything.
And again, it's all because Kaze gets comboed up, exhausted when he wants to bring out the damage, and hit right back into Steelvac's waiting arms. That exhaust was still running. No real way of the Fiora actually taking out Steelvac, so that's why that's not a dangerous play, and in fact is an okay one. And for the rest of this fight, Memento and Parang always moving forward. Raze with a beautiful double combo manages to catch Tabs just before he gets the headbutt away. I guess Alistair did get the change to make that combo a little bit easier, but still credit where it's due at that point for Roccat. They managed to take out the team fight, take out the inhibitor, and have put themselves in control. As you said, it's only a slight lead for now, but a lead is a lead.
And of course, as that replay was going down, we did see Millenium pick up the Cloud Drake for themselves. Next Drake will, of course, be the Elder. Get that overlay updated in just a moment. But in the meantime, Roccat now backing off. Minute and 40 left for Baron. They've seen what one Baron could do for them, and they're looking for another. Of course, Millenium caught in a little bit of a tough spot here. Fiora going to be a lot harder to split pressure. There's a wave of supers constantly coming down that mid lane.
It's fairly difficult for Millenium to take extended team fights in this as well, because Roccat have two Guardian Angels. One of them has been popped, and obviously all of their team fighting prowess alongside that. So you basically have to kill Echo three times. He's got the GA, the ultimate, all of those stuns that are going to come out on fairly low cooldown as well. At parallel conversions right now, only just over 14 seconds. When you look at it, going to be able to get perhaps two stuns during an engage. With the GA, should certainly be able to. So for Millenium, they have to very difficultly balance a lot of their damage. They have to somehow kill Steelback and Betsy, and then after that, they don't really have too much more to deal with. The damage that comes from Prang is somewhat negligible unless he can stick on a target.
Of course, news from the stats overlords has come in. 30k nice. Damage has already come out from Pretty this game. Only 17k from Betsy. But when we look back at that one team fight where Malzahar just got to lay everything down over a wall, I think he burned through at least 5k health in that single instant. So definitely terrifying. I feel like there's Millennium are absolutely not out of the game yet. And when we look at this, small gold advantage for Roccat, pretty negligible in the face of those extra dragons. And I think it's all going to come down to who gets this Baron.
And that's the thing, is it's actually somewhat deceptive that Roccat have a lead, because you look at it, 6-2 Fiora, 6-2 Malzahar. I'm like, oh, well, Roccat is slightly in the lead on this one, guys. I certainly feel like Millenium absolutely
Raze
have the opportunity.
In trouble, ulted down, knocked back. He's still ticking forward. He's going to lose some health. Walks back into the null zone. That's not what you want.
Steelback.
But Betsy running rampant, and Steelback is still alive. Keep your eyes on the Fiora, because she is not coming to the fight. Betsy trying to get more, trying to push forward, looking for a bit more damage. Laser Bird comes down. Memento not going to push any further. Never move, dashed out of. Both members make it to safety, but Fiora does not even use the teleport in that exchange.
Because she couldn't. Parang knew he didn't have his teleport, so he has one option. He must throw himself at Kaze. He knows he has a GA. He knows he has his ultimate, so he can survive through the trade while the rest of the team fight is going on. He knew he couldn't cross the distance as well, and had to keep Kaze in his lane against him. We'll see it in the replay when it eventually comes up. But Pretty falling in that team fight means that all of this gold that is on Millenium, every part of their power was split in two across the map, and they couldn't contend with the rest of Roccat. Memento still wants to go, but they don't feel like taking the Baron out right now. They had the opportunity, but did not go for it.
I guess there's been so many steals this game that they don't even want to take the risk. They had the man advantage. The only person threatening them was Joko, and they don't even go for the opportunity.
So keep at least a little focus on the minimap here as this fight progresses. Raze gets blasted down to begin this fight. He's already basically a goner before this starts, which normally would be a good thing for Millennium, meaning the exhaust is out of the equation, but watch what Parang does on the minimap here. Chases Kaze through the jungle as the rest of the fight is going. Steelback stays alive for the majority of this, and that then allows Roccat to kind of regroup on top of it. Memento picks up the rest of the kills, and Betsy is providing enough threat to push Millennium back away. So Roccat managed to split Millennium up and take the two fights simultaneously.
Roccat, unfortunately, did not really get a whole lot from winning that team fight. Yes, the gold lead extends a little bit. They're not able to get any larger objectives. They are able to clear out a bit more jungle, get down a bit more vision, maybe set up for a future fight. However, now after all this, they finally decide to pull the trigger on the Baron. All five members grouped here. Fiora still pushing on the bottom side. Masterwork caught out. He's all alone. Ray's looking for backing off now as the ultimate comes out. Gragas knocks him back into the team. Betsy going gold. The Memento is going to respawn in a second, but Betsy has to flash over the wall. And here comes Kaze. He's going to get cut down almost instantaneously. Steelback is a man without fear, but Masterwork is here to block his shots as Kaze drops the Echo, but drops to the bird himself. Betsy, still alive, comes back in to turn the fight in Roccat's favor. And now, with no fear left, they're going to push for the Baron.
Massively extended fight from both teams here results in the Roccat victory over the team fight. Now they look for the Baron. They've got that one down. No real steal opportunity was available for Millenium. And that was a pretty hectic fight, and there's a couple of really influential things. Note, Tabs has just picked up a Mortal Reminder. So as Betsy goes aggressive into this fight and takes the damage from Tabs, he's so close to dying, but the Zhonya's allows him to stay alive. The flash over the wall to
keep himself
safe.
Oh, Tabs fumbles the dash too.
Exactly, Tabs isn't able to keep on top of him. And as they push forward here, parallel convergence from Parang, right as Kaze comes up, is able to at least give himself the time to get the shield into the GA, and it allows the rest of the damage to come out from Roccat. Very extended team fight with just the survival tools coming out from Roccat, but look at the damage combined from Steelback and Betsy. That is an insane amount. Like 13,500 damage from two people.
Ooh. The four item sliver approaching the fifth item now. Betsy similarly with a massive impact for the team. Roccat say, we already got the Baron, why not go for the Elder as well? Joko is here though. They have the vision. Roccat aren't sweeping it out.
I've seen it with this ward multiple times.
Wait, is he gonna go for it, Joko? Locked up, stun does still come down. Parang, secure helps the
MVP.
I was convinced that he could go for the steal there, but Parang going to make sure that that drops down. They may only have one dragon backing them up, but with the Elder buff as well, Roccat now poised to take just about any fight that they're placed in.
Parallel convergence.
There's just zoning them off the team.
There's a lot of parallel.
Yep.
That's a tongue twister. That is a difficult one.
Yes. Continuing forward. Oh, aggressive moves coming in. Kaze caught out. Kaze burned down instantly. Steelback on a rampage. Snapback from Parang and Masterwork. Suddenly the one left alone. Staring contest comes in. Instantly canceled. Parang still alive as the tower drops. And Betsy, the fearless frontliner, Raze making the engage happen. Team members starting to drop. The double kill comes in from Betsy. Roccat cut through Millenium one last time as they push in to take game one.
It didn't look as convincing as Roccat would have liked. Millenium coming out firing at the beginning of game one, but Roccat will be the ones taking game one in this best of five.
Truly an insane turnaround after a few mistakes in the early game. Roccat looking so down and out. The 4-1 Fiora seemed unstoppable, but amazing team fighting prowess carrying them through to the end. And Millenium just walking away empty-handed in game one.
A weird draft for this game as well, or at least the pacing on the draft, and ends up kind of completely different to what other teams have done against Roccat.
And those fights were so back and forth.
Yeah.
So many members with insane amounts of sustain. The Fiora with the double lifesteal items, the Swain, the Sivir and the backlines. And it was, for so many of those fights, it was hard to call. But as we got later and later in the game, you can't group up against the Sivir Swain. It's simply too much damage.
So tough to group up against it. And I mean, despite losing the game, Pretty still had the most damage of nearly 48,000 damage in that game.
Good spot.
A lot of damage for Swain and Sivir came right in those last two team fights. But man, Steelback once again showing if you give him the space, he's able to clean up. Betsy showing if you give him the Swain, despite it being somewhat out of the meta with a lot of mid laners, still able to perform fairly well, especially into that Malzahar matchup as well. Normally a very, very tough one.
I think what surprised me the most was how, despite being behind, Roccat continually went for those team fights and took some of those risks and were confident in their ability to outplay it. But at the same time, Millenium, you got the queen of split pushing, the unstoppable split pusher, and you're sending her to group and team fights. Or you're not sending her to group and team fights, and she's not doing anything on the sideline. It feels like there were some issues there.
Roccat, though, their fans will breathe a sigh of relief for Memento, because honestly, I think if that Baron goes over to Millenium and they have that to push, I don't know whether Roccat really come back in that
game.
You
don't come back from the Baron buffed up Fiora. But of course, Roccat has fired the first shot in this best of five, and to take a closer look at how they did it, let's send it over to the analyst desk.
Thank you very much, CFAM. We're going to kick off straight away with picks and